Since this is day three, I think everybody knows that Europe last year confronted an unprecedented refugee or migrant crisis when more than 1.25 million people came to the Now this refugee crisis actually raised a number of economic, social, political, foreign policy, or security dimensions and challenges. What came across to us quite clearly was that Europe was basically unable to cope with this huge influx of migrants, which dominated public debates and policy discussions, became issue number one, and it also created deep divisions amongst European prime ministers. The migrant crisis came on top of a succession of crises, you know, the global financial crisis, the Eurozone crisis, slow economic recovery, decline of mutual trust among member states, lack of adequate political leadership. I think the first thing we should ask is this crisis different from previous migrant crises that Europe has confronted? This is not the first time that Europe has witnessed massive movements of people across Europe. For example, during World War I, there were 1 million Belgian refugees in the Netherlands. Nearly 800,000 people crossed over from the former Yugoslavia into Western Europe. And in fact, between 1988 and 1992, Germany itself, in these 4 years, received over 3 million people, which included ethnic Germans, about 1.35 million, and nearly 2 million people from the South European member states as well as Turkey. The difference today is there is less identification geographically, there is no Cold War framework, and there is no feeling of post-World War II colonial guilt, which was the cause of a large number of migrants coming to Europe. The second question I think we should ask is, why was Europe able to cope with the crisis? This most advanced regional economy in the world was clearly unable to cope with the crisis, largely because there was the collapse of the asylum system. Asylum policy, which was there in the Dublin regulation, which said the responsibility for registering and processing asylum applications rested with the country from which the migrants or refugees first entered. And then they went on to the destination countries, that is where they ultimately wanted to go. And it allowed the ultimate destination country to send back these refugees or migrants to the country of where they first entered. So what we found was that more than 80% of the migrants in Europe entered from maritime routes through two countries, namely Greece and Italy. And the end destination were the favored ones were Sweden and Germany. I'll shortly tell you why. Now the image of the Syrian Goa island Kurdi, who was washed up on a Turkish beach, you know, touched the hearts of many Europeans, but not for too long. Soon gave way for pressures, even within Sweden and Germany, to stop the flow. So what were the major European Union responses? The first thing they came up with was a relocation of 160,000 refugees from Italy and Greece to other Schengen states. Secondly, the establishment of processing centers or hotspots on the EU's external borders. Thirdly, they expanded financial allocations both in the EU and in the countries where the refugees were coming from. You know, about 7 million within Syria, then also within Turkey, about 2 million. They also increased their commitments to various human programs, and they said that we will establish a European Border and Coast Guard to replace the Frontex, the Frontier Guard system, which apparently did not work well. If you look amongst the member states, what were kind of the responses to these EU reactions to the migrant crisis? Several EU member states voted against the mandatory quota system, like the Czech Republic, Romania, Slovakia, Hungary, about which my colleague possibly will talk to you a little while. Other states like Poland opposed introducing a permanent relocation scheme. And there were states which were reluctant to accept refugees, and they came up with their own individual solutions to the problem. Like like Hungary raised fences. Some countries closed their borders to prevent money flow. Many countries reintroduced national controls. And more countries did this, this set up a kind of a domino effect. And then also you had this most recently €3 billion deal with Turkey, which perhaps was expected might deal with the problem. So therefore, the one conclusion we come from this brief discussion is that it was burden shifting rather than burden sharing, which was the key EU response. On the face of it, it seems that, you know, EU with 28 member states with a population of 500 million, 500 million people, 160,000 refugees shouldn't be really a big problem. But soon, it turned to a process where the richer and more ethnically and culturally diverse countries, primarily Germany and Sweden, they took in the bulk of refugees. In Germany talked about this to 1.1 million. Now, actually, you have three kinds of groups of states within the European Union. First, you have the countries of first arrival, that is Greece, Italy, primarily because they have, you know, there are many Greek islands which are very close to Turkey. And these countries were determined to get out of this strict, stringent asylum system of the Dublin Regulation because it was not made to cope with the sheer size of the crisis. Secondly, you had the second category were the transit countries, you know, which sought to divert the inflow of migrants to their ultimate destination, which for many was Austria, Sweden, and Germany. And they wanted to close the countries. Now, the fact that relocation of 160,000 refugees has failed to work is evident from the fact that by January 2016, only about 300 out of the 160,000 refugees had been relocated. Let's ask, why was Germany the favored destination? Well, largely because of the historical background and a rather liberal asylum policy. It was a country, along with Sweden, which was considered most liberal, where there were high wages and which had a legacy of generous social welfare systems. So this was the country of the number one on their list. But when 1.1 million refugees, mostly from Syria, more than half of them, came to Germany, pressure seemed to mount on Angela Merkel, and then soon she closed the border in Austria, which had, as I said, kind of a domino effect. But the funny thing was, when she demanded solidarity from other member states having taken the bulk of the burden, other countries said, told the German chancellor, look, it was your welcoming gesture. Merkel, Mama, welcoming, you know, the Syrians, they were very glad she welcomed them with open arms. But this further complicated the situation because Berlin was criticized that it created some of the burden by being so welcoming to the refugees. So in Germany, the question was not whether it could bear the cost of financial cost of the migration crisis. The Germans were losing confidence whether they could really meaningfully integrate them into their society. The political dimension within the European Union was also very important because soon the debate became highly tense, emotional, and initial sympathy gave way to concern and anxiety. And most politicians across Europe tended to view this from the perspective of domestic politics, and especially right-wing politicians, right-wing parties, which seemed to profit from this anti-immigrant and furthering a nationalist agenda. Now, as a result of this, mainstream parties also became immigrant restrictive. More interestingly, after the Paris attacks in November 2015, carried out by the Islamic State group, many people established a link between terrorism and the influx of migrants, mostly from the Islamic world. And this made discussion even more difficult about resettlement and relocation because people, especially of people arriving from Syria. Now, this was made up by the media, even though the problem was more of homegrown terrorism. The social dimension within the European Union was also very important because, and you found a variety of attitudes amongst societies across Europe. On the one hand, you had the largely globalized societies of Western and Northern Europe, especially Germany and Sweden, which only had hosted large immigrant communities. Then you have the societies of Central Europe, which had lived in isolation for 45 years under Soviet control, and only rejoined, returned to the European Union since 1990. And they were therefore much less prepared to deal with the migrants and very strong nationalist reactions. There were also differences within countries. For example, within Germany, while Western Germany was relatively more welcoming, Eastern Germany had a tradition of being, had a rather skeptical attitude towards welcoming immigrants and non-immigrants. The concerns and risks of rapid immigration dominated the public discourse in France and the UK. And it was not that xenophobic rival parties played a role across all member states. In some they were very active, in other states the discourse was not very prominent. Now, according to a Eurobarometer poll conducted in November 2015, which has only been published last month, European citizens today see the migrant crisis as the biggest threat to the European Union, even greater than terrorism or the economic crisis. So 58% of the respondents ranked immigration among the top two problems of the European Union. Most Europeans, about 68%, were in favor of a common European solution to the migration crisis, with around 25% were opposed to it. And attitudes seem to be strongly conditioned by the origin of the migrants. For example, 51% French citizens saw internal migration within the Schengen area to be a positive light, whereas 30% compared to non-EU migration. Now, one thing which emerges quite clearly from this migration crisis is that in the previous decades, Europe does not have the image of the achievement of an open-minded, multicultural society as a whole. It has in fact never been willing to confront the formidable challenge of stabilizing and assimilating marginalized migrant populations. They have held out a hand of friendship, have even voted funds for admission and resettlement. The hands have only been half-stretched, and the purse strings have only been partially opened. The next question is, will the Schengen system survive? Now, the Schengen system, as you know, allows free travel within 26 members, two of which are not members of the Schengen, which are not members of the European Union, namely Norway and Switzerland. But the Schengen agreement allows countries to impose restrictions from up to 6 months, which eventually could be extended up to 2 years, in case of national crisis like the one that Europe faces today. Now, if the Schengen system were to collapse, what would it mean? It would mean that 1.7 million people who travel every day to work in another country, they would be affected. More importantly, the Commission estimates that it would cost between 5 to 18 billion euros a year if national controls were restored. In just about 2 weeks ago, a month ago, the European Union came up with a roadmap that by the end of the year they would restore the full Schengen system. But most people feel that the present crisis would not result in the dismantling of the Schengen system, but it would change the way it works. Now, some general conclusions before I finish. Is this migration crisis over? No. Europe will confront the migration challenge for many years, if not decades, and refugees will continue to come to Europe as long as the conflict and the chaos from which they run away continue. Growing migration can in fact be also expected from Africa, which according to UN forecasts will see a doubling of its population by 2050. So there's a literal demographic bomb brewing in this region. So migration will fluctuate but will probably remain at high levels. What we notice is that Europe is temporarily unprepared to deal with migrants and asylum seekers in the region. Now, looking to the future, there are three key challenges. Number one, what kind of strategies should the European Union adopt towards the migrants? Should it be one of integration versus isolation, dialogue versus polarization? Especially because in the past, European elites have consistently pursued policies of exclusion and marginalization of immigrant communities. The second challenge is that will the image of migrants and asylum seekers be reinforced by media coverage, which does a lot of scapegoating, and link them to terrorism, drug trafficking, and violent crimes, whereas many of the problems are by already residents in the Schengen area, largely a problem of terrorism. And finally, should migrants be regarded as an opportunity to deal with the problems of the demographic decline, to ameliorate the difficulties of a welfare state, or should they be seen as a threat to Europe as a whole? I think